I have the immense pleasure of welcoming one of the visitors from around the world to chair today's session, Professor John Paul Sidner. He is the professor of divinity in Emmanuel University, and he describes in his resume that he enjoys teaching Hinduism as a lived reality and not as an abstract religion. I think that is very relevant to today's world. As Swami said this morning, what is important to us is to imbibe what is being taught in our daily lives and live that. So we are in for a treat from Professor John Paul Sidner, who is going to talk about the relationship between God and souls as established by Ramanuja. And hopefully we can learn a lot from him and how to apply in our daily lives. So I invite Professor Sidner to come to the stage, please. The next participant in this session is Sriman T.K. Parthasarathi Swami. Tillaisthanam Parthasarathi Swami, I request him to come to the stage. He is a very well-known person. He did a lot of, he occupied great positions in the printing paper industry, and then later on focused his learning Vaishnavism from University of Madras and Srivatsankaracharya and others. And he is going to be speaking to us about pantheism or panentheism in Ramanuja's philosophy. The third participant in this session is, I have been given the opportunity to participate in this session by Rangaramanachilaya Swami. My name is Varadhan, and I have the honor and good fortune of learning from scholars here and serving this organization and Swami. So I'll go sit.
I'd like to thank everybody for being here, and I'd like to thank Swamiji for the gracious invitation to be here. I was very honored to receive the invitation. I hope that what I have to say is helpful. And before we begin, everybody else has offered a prayer, so I too would like to offer a prayer before we begin, so let us pray. Dear God, may the words which I am about to speak make us more aware of your presence in heaven. May these words make us more aware of your presence in ourselves. May these words make us more aware of your presence in our neighbor. And may these words make us more aware of your presence in this magnificent cosmos that you have created and that you sustain. Amen. So I'd like to, my PowerPoint went away. Come back, there you go. My presentation today is basically, I'm gonna argue for what in Western philosophical terms is called a non-dual theological epistemology. I'm gonna break that down a little bit. What that means is in the West, we have a tendency to think in an either or framework. We have something called the law of non-contradiction. We say if A, then not B, or if B, then not A. In the Asian context, particularly in the Indian context, it's much more common to think with an and or framework, or a both and framework. In other words, you can think both A and B. They're not exclusive. We're not operating with an exclusivist law of non-contradiction. What I'm going to argue is that in theology, we need, particularly in the West and in the Christian tradition, I'm a practicing Christian who studies Ramanuja, but we need to think in more of a both and framework rather than an either or framework. And I'm going to give you some examples of different religious experiences that human beings can have. I'm going to argue that the richest life available to us is by honoring all of those religious experiences, and that Ramanuja helps us to interpret those religious experiences as having one source, as being perfectly compatible or coherent. And therefore, Ramanuja allows us not only to think better about God and spiritual life, but to experience God and the spiritual life in a deeper and more rich way. So that's my argument. I'm going to have a slideshow here. I will skip a few slides, and then a little autobiography just to give you some orientation. I'm also an ordained minister. I'm a Protestant pastor. I'm married to a Protestant pastor. My wife is a Protestant pastor. And together we pastor a church. It's called Grace Community Boston. We have a Facebook page. Like a lot of religious institutions, we have a Facebook page, and we create memes on our Facebook page, and we try to propagate our message, our interpretation of Christianity through this Facebook page. And I make most of the memes, and these are some of the memes. I'm going to use a bunch of the memes that I've created in my presentation. So this is one of the memes that I created. Our church is very open to the truth found in other religions. So I just said that God is too big to fit inside any one religion. So we can learn from other religions. In fact, I would say God calls us to learn from other religions. So with regard to religions and religious truth, we take a both and framework. We can learn from Hinduism and from Christianity. We can learn from Vishnu and from Christ. I also believe that when we seek what is truest in our own tradition, we discover that we are one with those who seek what is truest in their tradition. And I've been experiencing that this week during my visit to the ashram, as I see the social welfare that the ashram does, and the belief in equality and concern for all that the ashram propagates, I find very much myself seeing what I value highest in my tradition being expressed in this ashram as well. So my argument, I kind of went over, and I'm going to skip a few slides to stay within the time frame. So just to review my thesis real quick, I think that we experience God, the sacred, in a number of ways. Specifically, we experience a personal God. We experience a divine presence in ourself and our neighbor. We experience a divine presence in the material cosmos, in the universe. Matter seems to be enchanted. We also experience a divine summons to ethical conduct, to be kind and compassionate toward one another. We can also experience God in the rational order of the universe. In other words, the practice of reason itself can be experienced as sacred, and we can experience transformative power in ritual practice. So, the problem is that some people believe these to be exclusive. Particularly in my own tradition, there are some who would assert that God is personal, but not to be found in humankind or in the material universe. And I find that detrimental to spiritual life. So, first, religious experience one, God is a transcendent relational person. This is obviously very central in Sri Vaishnavism. You can also find it in the Christian and Hebrew Jewish traditions. This is just a quote from the Hebrew scriptures, which the Christians call the Old Testament. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of us, mortals that you care for us? Yet you have made us a little lower than the divine and crowned us with glory and honor. In other words, this is a very relational, religious sentiment. We are on earth, God is in heaven, God has made the universe, and it's magnificent. It's the experience of God as a person who cares for us. Now, the problem comes when we interpret that in an either-or context, and when we believe that to experience God as a relational person precludes or excludes experiencing God in others or in the material universe. And this is a problem, I think it's a problem, in the Christian tradition. And that's because the Christian tradition originally said that God was not in the material created universe. And it said that for historical reasons. The Christian tradition saw Jesus as being of one substance with God. So, if the universe and we were of one substance with God, then we would be equal with Jesus, and Jesus would not be unique. So for that reason, the Christian tradition, many leaders in the Christian tradition, very early argued that the universe and we, regular mortals, are not of one substance with God. We're of a different substance from God and Jesus Christ. So this is just a classic expression of that. This is from Saint Augustine, one of the most influential theologians in the Christian tradition. He said, "In the beginning, that is from yourself, in your wisdom, which is begotten of your substance," this is Jesus, okay? Jesus is the wisdom. "You made something and made it out of nothing." So it's not made from you. It's not emanated. It's made from nothing. Okay? "For you made heaven and earth not out of your own self." Or, because if you did that, it would be equal to your only begotten Son, Jesus, and therefore to yourself. But the universe can't be equal to Jesus or yourself. It's got to be separate. "It cannot possibly be right for anything which is not of you to be equal to you." Okay, so what this resulted in was something that's called classical theism in the Christian tradition. And what you end up with is this kind of interpretation where there's God in the universe, we're in the universe, but we are separate from God, of a separate substance from God. What I'm arguing for, what Ramanuja argued for, is that God contains the universe. God is beyond the universe, but also within the universe at the same time. That's the first religious experience. Here's another religious experience: God as experienced in self and neighbor. Or in other words, God as experienced in human beings. So this is a quote from George Fox. He's the founder of Quakerism in the Christian tradition. He writes, "The Lord showed me so that I did see clearly that he did not dwell in these temples which men had commanded and set up, but in people's hearts. His people were his temple, and he dwelt in them. There is that of God in every man." And that's probably the most famous basic phrase of Quakerism. There is that of God in every man. So what we're having here is a sentiment that God is in the people that we meet and interact with. I'm going to have to skip a few. I also found a similar sentiment in the Shaivite tradition with Vivekananda. And then very basically, from the Christian tradition again, "We cannot see God in anyone until we see God in everyone." That's a quote by St. Catherine Laboure. So at its best, this sentiment that God is in everyone results in a theistic egalitarianism. In other words, and that's expressed, I think radically expressed, by the carrying of the Dalit into a temple here by one of the priests in the temple. So a very symbolic act, an act of radical social equality, and also a expression that God is in everyone, and that renders us radically equal in God's eyes. So this results in a kind of interdivine human ethics, where all human-to-human interaction is also God-to-God interaction. Therefore, should be kind and compassionate. Problems result when you approach an either-or, approach this with an either-or framework, and you begin to see God as in people, but not in heaven or in the earth. And the worst example of this in human history was the Nazi Party of Germany under Adolf Hitler. For Hitler, the German people themselves were sacred. Their blood was sacred. They were divine. They were what he worshipped. And because his seeing the divine in the German people, but then rejecting belief in God, rejecting normal ethical conduct, not seeing God in anybody outside the German people, it became a horrific, violent experience. At the same time, the German people were practicing idolatry. They were worshiping something not worthy of worship by worshiping Hitler himself, and that worship being uninformed by worship of God. So the religious experience three is that because we experience God in other people, we are summoned to ethical conduct. And this is another quote from the Christian scriptures. Jesus says in the Christian scriptures, "I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me." In other words, he's inviting people to see himself in everyone, and thereby to see God in everyone. So there's a summons there to ethical conduct. You find similar summons in the Bhagavad Gita. "Strive constantly to serve the welfare of the world. By devotion to selfless work, one attains the supreme goal of life. Do your work with the welfare of others always in mind." But at its worst, this can become a form of legalism, rigoristic legalism. And sometimes there are religious people who will try to follow rules more than they do anything else. They're more strict about rules than they are joyful or compassionate toward others. So legalism tends to be an emphasis on personal virtue or holiness with little to no concern for social welfare, a judgmental attitude toward self and others based on their strict adherence to rules or doctrines, anxiety about ethical performance instead of joy in received grace, and a lack of compassion toward human foibles, tending to be merciless and unforgiving. And I think that in the biography of Ramanuja, we see multiple acts of resistance toward legalism. He challenged the orthodoxy of his day. He challenged what people thought uncritically. He befriended the fifth Varna, for example. So I believe that this challenge to legalism can also be seen in Ramanuja's own conduct. The fourth religious experience is that God is experienced in the material universe that God creates and sustains. Black Elk, who's a Native American, an American Indian, if you will, he stated, "The Holy Land is everywhere." In other words, you don't have to go to Jerusalem or Rome to find the Holy Land. The Holy Land is everywhere. That's because he saw God as everywhere in the earth. And then there's another American, his name's John Muir. He's not a Christian, he was a naturalist. And he said, "No synonym for God is so perfect as beauty. Whether as seen carving the lines of the mountains with glaciers, or gathering matter into stars, or planning the movements of water, or gardening, still all is beauty." So he sees God in all matter. He sees God in the beauty of the universe itself, and he celebrates that. That is his primary experience of the sacred. Now, this presents to us a spiritual opportunity that I would argue. This is a great quote. It's by the Jamaican reggae singer Bob Marley. I don't know if you've heard of him or not. Great musician. But he said, "Some people just get wet. Others feel the rain." And that's actually a deep quote. He's saying, you know, if you get caught in a rainstorm, some people are just inconvenienced by it. Some people can actually celebrate the existence of the water in their own existence and the way that God has blessed us with water. Now, if you take this in an either-or framework, and if you say that God is in matter, but in matter alone, then you end up with something that in the West we call pantheism. Pantheism is the belief that God is the material universe, the material universe is God, and there's no personal God beyond the material universe. There's no personal God in our neighbors, self and other. It's just the worship of nature alone. And that pantheism is a real religious option. Some people, this is a meme I found on a pantheistic website, "Nature is my religion, the earth is my temple." So God is now gone, and just the worship of the universe itself is how the person practices their religion. So that's an either-or framework that they're working with. I'm going to skip that. Religious experience 5, God is experienced through reason, including the mathematical order of the universe, or the universe expresses the mind of God. Now, this one's very interesting. You can find this. This is from the 14th century. This is God the Geometer. And it kind of implies that God, as the creator of the universe, is also a brilliant mathematician. Okay, so God's genius is inscribed within the material order of the universe, and we can access that genius through reason. Now, I believe that to be true, but some people interpret this, again, with an either-or framework that excludes God from the picture. So what you have here is you end up with what's called mathematical exclusivism. This is Stephen Hawking. And Stephen says, God is the name people give to the reason we are here. But I think that reason is the laws of physics rather than someone with whom one can have a personal relationship. In other words, now you have mathematics, but no God. Mathematics don't come from God. They're just kind of like there, and we don't know where they came from. Max Tegmark has a similar quote, which I will skip. And this finally, religious experience 6, the sacred is experienced through ritual, but that can dangerously become ritualism when ritual practice loses its joy and its meaning and is done simply as kind of a rote practice. So, to sum up, human beings can experience the sacred in many different ways. Unfortunately, approaching these experiences with a binary either-or logic forces a choice between them or distorts their true nature. If we apply the law of non-contradiction to religious experience, then we end up with a string of competing exclusivisms rather than a God-saturated universe. Fortunately, a better interpretation of the varieties of religious experience is possible, and I believe that interpretation is best provided by Ramanujan. So, using Ramanujan's work, I'm going to make a case for a non-dual, both-and epistemology, or way of thinking about religion and religious life. Both-and, not either-or. That's what we're trying to do here. So, and I think that the person, first of all, we could get biographical inspiration from Ramanujan in his own tendency to think in a both-and framework. Ramanujan was faced with what seemed like forced choices. Should he write in Tamil or Sanskrit? Who were the true carriers of the religious tradition, the Alvars or the Vedas? Which is real, Prakriti or Purusha? Which is more important, the body or the soul? And what he did was he responded, instead of taking this either-or framework, he chose a both-and framework. And he said, well, we're going to work with Tamil and Sanskrit. We're going to use the Alvars and the Vedas. We're going to value Prakriti and Purusha, and we're going to celebrate our possession of the body and the soul. So, but he did this in a very theologically sophisticated way, because Ramanujan believed that faith should fulfill reason, not offend reason. In other words, faith should be rational. So a little bit, I want to explain how he did that. This is my take, that Ramanujan's trimodal, three different modes, the mode of God, souls, and matter, his trimodal, monosubstantial, God, souls, and matter are one substance, they're all Narayana. Ramanujan's trimodal, monosubstantial, divine ontology, his metaphysic, what he thinks about God, provides us with a means by which to reconcile our varieties of religious experience as sourced in one God. So, Narayana is first and foremost an embodied personal being with a beautiful form, a beautiful divine form. This form of Narayana explains our experience of the sacred as a transcendent personal relational God In other words, Narayana is in heaven, and we are on earth, and Narayana is available for our relationship with him. Now, hence, we experience the sacred as a transcendent personal being. At the same time, Narayana is superabundant, Narayana is infinite, so Narayana's nature is to overflow. That overflow results in the world of the jivas. So Narayana emanates jivas, they're from Narayana's own being, and the jivas are of one substance with Narayana, but of a different mode, or prakara. So, hence, that's why we experience the sacred as present in self and other. So, we experience the sacred in the divine summons to care for one another, in the summons to ethical conduct, in the call, the sacred call to be kind and compassionate. But Narayana also emanates Prakirti, which is of the same substance as Narayana, but of a different mode from Narayana in the jivas. And this, the scene, nature scene behind, represents Prakirti. So now we have a personal Narayana, jivas who are emanated by Narayana, and a material cosmos, which is also emanated by Narayana. Hence, we experience the sacred in all that is natural, physical, and psychological. And, note the word and there, which I put in all caps, we experience God in the divine summons to care for the environment, because the environment is God, and we can experience the sacred in the rational order of the universe, and I would like to talk about this picture briefly. This is a picture of Vishnu emanating the universe, and it explains how Vishnu can be located somewhere in Vaikuntha and everywhere at the same time. And we are in Vishnu's dream. Of course, Vishnu's dreaming is not like our dreaming. It's purposeful. It's directed. But because we are in Vishnu's dream, what we are in is pervaded by the mind of Vishnu. And because it's pervaded by the mind of Vishnu, it is saturated with Vishnu's brilliance. And that is why people like Stephen Hawking and Max Tegmark are discovering mathematical genius in the universe. It's because it's Narayana's mind. It's not because it's mathematical by nature. It's divine by nature and mathematical due to its divinity. We can experience the sacred in the performance of God-directed ritual. So Ramanuja's monosubstantial, trimodal divine ontology allows us to live in a God-saturated universe that legitimates and contextualizes all forms of religious experience. We leave nothing out with Ramanuja's ontology. So in other words, God wants you to be totally alive. Everything that comes from God is life-giving. The other person, yourself, your own soul, matter, God himself are all life-giving. Ramanuja's divine ontology celebrates difference as a gift from God. As a divine gift, difference, when I say difference, I mean that things are different from each other. We're different souls, and red is different from blue, and hard is different from soft, so we live in a universe of difference. But difference is a gift from God. As a divine gift, difference does not exist to divide us. Instead, difference exists to be united by us through worship and service to God. So Ramanuja's theology later came to be called Vishishtadvaita, or qualified non-dualism. Qualified means that difference is real. Non-dualism means that difference is harmonious and unified. So Ramanuja's theology declares the absolute fundamental unity of all difference is God, difference is real, and unity is real. And that's a profound call, political call to political unity, and a communal call to communal unity as well. As a Christian, I subscribe to the monosubstantial trimodal divine ontology of Ramanuja, coupled with his non-dual, both and, unitive epistemology, way of thinking. I believe that reality is beta-beta, both different and non-different at the same time, grounded in God, yet distinguishable from God. So, while continuing to accept the doctrine of divine creation, I have rejected the traditional Christian doctrine of creatio ex nihilo, that God is separate from the universe. I just don't believe that anymore. I think it fails to experience the way that we experience God in matter, and in ourself, and in our neighbor. So, as a subscriber to the divine ontology of Ramanuja, I could be called a Vishish Advaita Christian. Insofar as I accept the reality of ontological difference as coming from God, and I celebrate that difference, yet I always work to reveal the fundamental unity of all in God. Thank you for your time and attention. So our next speaker will be Sriman T.K. Partasarathi. Yes. He will be speaking on very similar to my own talk, so this will help clarify things where I confused you, I'm sure. He will be discussing pantheism or panentheism in Ramanuja's philosophy.
Let us have a brief 5 minutes estimation of this beautiful talk, our Swami.
Jai Srimanarayana. I'm not going to just talk anything against Mr. John Paul so far expressed. What a real thinker, a truth seeker talks about the realities of the life, realities of the universe, and reality of the some power behind what people call with different names, Bahudha Vadanti, whatever the name may be, whether he is a Christian, whether he is a Hindu, whether he is an Islamic person, or whether a person is a Vaishnav or a Saivite or whatever it is, but a truth seeker, a person who really looks into the life, whatever way that he understands, is what Mr. John Paul very well expressed. And of course, that's what Ramanuja did too, but for which he took the authoritativeness of Veda as a guiding factor for the life, for the knowledge, and for understanding as well. So, what he said as Tattvatrayam, that means three realities, what Ramanuja holds always in his hands, what, of course, we also follow Ramanuja and holds that three danda. Each danda talks about the reality of the nature, as some scientists said, reality of the soul, as some other people believed in, and reality of the ultimate power behind God. God can be anywhere, God can be in a form, and also permeate every object, as he rightly pointed it out. So God can be in heaven, God can be within us, God can be even within an atom, and everywhere, so that it takes a form and a name. So that is the power of that person who expressed his scientific ability in terms of mathematics, just like the Hawkins. Because of the presence of that illimitable power of God within even that small, tiny soul, will be able to do that kind of scientific feat or mathematical feat. All these three are together, at the same time maintaining their own identity. So, Sriman, our Mr. Jean Paul. But enough, Jean Paul. He's Mr. Jean Paul, and that's Mr. Gopal. So, well expressed this, his ideology, as he also got that inspiration from Ramanuja to support his ideology. So we appreciate the way he expressed it. It's so beautiful. Jai Shrimanarayan.
I'm very pleased and honored to have been invited to the International Seminar on Bhagavan Ramanuja. This is my first conference with exclusively Hindus and my first real immersion in a Hindu ashram. And I have found the other presentations about Ramanuja to be very interesting. I've learned a lot, and my own thought has been changed by the conference. And also, I'm pleased to have been invited from America and to attend this conference in India. Very honored by their graciousness in bringing me here. So I'd like to thank Swamiji again for inviting me. And I'd like to thank the ashram for hosting me. And I'd like to thank all the other scholars who have provided me with so much stimulation while I've been here. So we were also given the opportunity to visit the new statue of Ramanuja, which is now going to be the second largest sitting statue in the world. I was enormously impressed by it. Although it's put together from different pieces of metal, you can't see the seams. I was pleased to get a preview of the light show that will be on Ramanuja's statue in the evenings. That was amazing. And the surrounding temples will also be very impressive. I hope to return to the ashram at some point in the future and visit the statue once it has been completed. Thank you very much.